Random House Audio presents The Kill Artist by Daniel Silva. Vienna, January 1991. The restorer raised his magnifying visor and switched off the bank of fluorescent lights. He waited for his eyes to adjust to the murkiness of evening in the cathedral. Then he inspected a tiny portion of the painting just below an arrow wound on the leg of St. Stephen. Over the centuries, the paint had worn completely down to the canvas. The restorer had so carefully repaired the damage that without the use of specialized equipment, it was now quite impossible to tell his work from the original, which meant he had done his job very well indeed. The restorer crouched on the work platform, wiped his brushes and palette, and packed away his dry pigments and oils. He dropped silently to the stone floor with the agility of a house cat. A knot of tourists had been watching him work for several minutes. An attractive German girl, a tourist, tried to engage him in her poor Italian. In rapid Berlin-accented German, his mother had lived in Charlottenburg before the war, the restorer said he was late for an appointment and could not talk now. "A coffee, perhaps, in the café across the square?" she asked. The restorer apologized and said he had to leave. "Besides," he said, looking up at the soaring nave, "this is Steffensdom, Fräulein, not a pickup bar." A moment later, he passed through the entrance of the cathedral and struck out in the snow. He was of medium height, well below 6 feet. His black hair was shot with gray at the temples, his nose long and angular, his lips full, his cheekbones broad and square. The box containing his paints and brushes was under his left arm, resting on the metal object that he wore habitually on his left hip. He walked along the Rotenturmstrasse, a broad pedestrian mall lined with bright shops and cafes, pausing before shop windows, peering at sparkling Montblanc pens and Rolex watches, even though he had no need for such things. He entered a telephone booth, slipped a shilling into the coin slot, and, while he scanned the street and storefronts around him, punched numbers. A recorded voice informed him that he had made a mistake. The restorer replaced the receiver, collected his shilling from the coin tray, kept walking. The restorer's wife and son were waiting for him at a small Italian restaurant, rear table, facing the door, according to their standing practice, in what had once been the bustling Jewish quarter. The restorer watched his wife for a moment, appraising her beauty the way he might assess a work of art, the technique, the structure, the composition. He entered the restaurant. He kissed his son on the top of the head, chatted in Italian with the man behind the bar, sat down. His wife poured wine for him. "Not too much. I have to work tonight."
"The cathedral?"
He pulled down his lips, cocked his head slightly.
"Are you packed?" he asked.
She nodded, then looked at the television above the bar. Air raid sirens over Tel Aviv, another Iraqi Scud missile. The restorer's wife reached across the table and touched his hand.
"I want to go home."
"Soon," the restorer said, and poured himself more wine.
She had left the car on the street just outside the restaurant, a dark blue Mercedes sedan, Vienna registration, leased by a small chemical company in Bern. The restorer placed the boy in the back seat, buckled his safety belt, kissed his wife.
"If I'm not there by 6 o'clock, something has gone wrong. You remember what to do?"
"Go to the airport, give them the password and the clearance number, and they'll take care of us."
6 o'clock, he repeated. "If I don't walk through the door by 6 o'clock, go straight to the airport. Leave the car in the parking lot and throw away the keys. Do you understand me?"
She nodded.
"Just be home by 6.
He closed the door, gave a terse wave through the glass, and started to walk away. In front of him, floating over the rooftops of the old city, was the spire of the cathedral, ablaze with light. One more night, he thought. Then home for a few weeks until the next job. Behind him, he heard the starter of the Mercedes engage, then hesitate,
like a record album being played at the wrong speed. The restorer stopped walking and spun around. No, he screamed, but she turned the key again. Port Navas, Cornwall, the present. By coincidence, Timothy Peel arrived in the village the same week in July as the stranger. He and his mother moved into a ramshackle cottage at the head of the tidal creek with her latest lover, a struggling playwright named Derek, who drank too much wine and detested children. The stranger arrived 2 days later, settling into the old foreman's cottage just up the creek from the oyster farm. Peel had little to do that summer. When Derek and his mother weren't making clamorous love, they were taking inspirational forced marches along the cliffs. So he determined to find out exactly who the stranger was and what he was doing in Cornwall. Peel decided the best way to begin was to watch. Because he was 11 and the only child of divorced parents, Peel was well-schooled in the art of human observation and investigation. Like any good surveillance artist, he required a fixed post. He settled on his bedroom window, which had an unobstructed view over the creek. In the storage shed, he found a pair of ancient Zeiss binoculars, and at the village store, he purchased a small notebook and ballpoint pen for recording his observations. The first thing Peel noticed was that the stranger liked old objects. His car was a vintage MG Roadster. Peel would watch him from his window, hunched over the motor for hours at a time, his back poking from beneath the bonnet. A man of great concentration, Peel concluded. A man of great mental endurance. After a month, the stranger vanished. Then he was back again, then gone again, then back once more. The stranger had a catch now, an old one, and sometimes he would disappear aboard the boat for days at a time. Peel could only imagine where the stranger was going. Down the Helford to the sea? Around the Lizard to Penzance? Cornwall was famous for pirates and smugglers. Perhaps the stranger was running the catch out to sea to meet cargo vessels and ferry contraband to shore. The large parcel, nearly as big as a barn door, actually, arrived the first week of September. It came in a van from London, accompanied by an agitated man in pinstripes. The stranger's days immediately assumed a reverse rhythm. At night, the top floor of the cottage burned with light. Not normal light, Peel observed, but a very clear white light. Peel was baffled. He needed a closer look. One evening, without telling his mother, he pulled on a sweater and coat and slipped out of the cottage. He stood on the quay, looking up at the stranger's cottage. The windows were open, a sharp odor hung on the air, something between rubbing alcohol and petrol. He could also hear music of some sort, singing, opera perhaps. He was about to move closer to the house when he felt a heavy hand on his shoulder. He spun around. Derek.
What in the bloody hell are you doing out here?
Derek blustered, his eyes wide with anger.
Your mother was worried sick.
If she was so worried, why did she send you?
Answer my question, boy. Why are you standing out here?
None of your business.
In the darkness, Peel did not see the blow coming. Open-handed, against the side of his head, hard enough to make his ear ring and bring water to his eyes.
You're not my father. You've no right.
And you're not my son. But as long as you live in my house, you'll do as I say.
Now Derek grabbed the boy roughly by the collar, and then suddenly he froze. Peel twisted his head around to see what was the matter. It was then that he saw the stranger, standing in the center of the lane, arms crossed in front of his chest.
What do you want? Snapped Derek.
I heard noises. I thought there might be a problem.
Peel realized this was the first time he had ever heard the stranger speak. His English was perfect, but there was a trace of an accent to it. His diction was like his body, hard, compact, concise, no fat.
No problem, Derek said. Just a boy who's someplace he shouldn't be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.